Students, are you able to see? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. This is epigastric pain. Today also I am going to share two case scenarios. Okay? The first student, can you read? Priveena.
Yes, sir.
Priveena Rajan, please read this.
56-year-old male with a history of gastroesophageal reflux disease, GERD, hypertension, and diabetes present to the emergency room complaining of severe upper central abdominal pain. The patient reports epigastric pain for months, but it has just acutely become intolerable over the last 8 hours. He states that the chronic pain has been growing pain that comes from after eating. He thought he was just having some indigestion and would take some antacids for relief. Late last night, the pain became
excruciating. Yeah.
Very severe.
Yeah. Yeah. Please
and
read.
Now he is having trouble moving.
Okay. What do you think? From this history itself, you can come to a diagnosis. Patient was having some problem, epigastric pain, for so many months, but now it becomes very severe, and it is very, very severe, excruciating. He is troubled in moving also. So what do you think, this epigastric pain to begin with, what is it? And now it is becoming very severe, what is it? Can you tell me? Priveena.
Peptic ulcer disease.
Now what happened? Why, peptic ulcer is there for months together. But what happens that this, yeah, gastric what?
Gastric
what happened?
Ulcer.
Why? Okay, gastric ulcer, it is there for several months. But what happened last night? Last night, what happened? Why it becomes very, very painful?
Gastroenteritis.
No.
Gastroenteritis.
Gastritis and all, it's there months together, that is PUD. But now why it becomes very severe? Did you watch all my videos yesterday, which I shared with you? Why suddenly it becomes very severe? It is perforated already. Patient is troubled in moving also. It is perforated peptic ulcer disease. Okay, right, you read the next page also. This also you read, Priveena.
On physical examination, blood pressure was under 30-70 millimeter mercury. Heart rate was 110 beats per minute and temperature is 101.5 Fahrenheit. He appears to be severe distress secondary to pain. The patient refused to straighten his legs because it hurts too much. He almost jumps off the table when you press on his abdomen. He has diffuse guarding and rebound tenderness.
And rigidity also. Rigidity also. Okay. Laboratory value. Yeah.
WC of 15. Yeah. Bun of 35. Keratin of 1.8. Serum MRIs of 70. And lipase of 60.
Okay.
And upright chest. Demonstrate free air under the right diaphragm. What would be your differential diagnosis and plan for further evaluation?
Okay, now you tell me, what is the medical terminology for free air under right diaphragm? Maybe I will go to the next student. Jefferson, are you there, Jefferson?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what is the medical terminology for free air under diaphragm?
Intrachronic air.
Pardon? No, I'm asking you, what is the medical terminology for free air under diaphragm?
Chilidity sign.
No, wrong, totally wrong. What is the medical terminology for free air under diaphragm? That is the cause? Pneumoperitoneum, okay, right. Can you tell me the differential diagnosis for free air under diaphragm? What are the causes for free air under diaphragm? Now you tell me. You told something previously. Now you tell me, what are the different causes for pneumoperitoneum?
One of them is the Chilaiditi syndrome.
Okay, Chilaiditi syndrome. Apart from that, what are the commonest causes? That is very rare cause, Chilaiditi. Tell me the common causes first, and then you can tell about Chilaiditi.
Perforated hollow viscous.
Perforated hollow viscous. Okay. Like what? Can you name some hollow viscous which can perforate?
Transverse colon.
Yeah, only colon.
Duodenum.
Duodenum, colon. Okay. What else? All. No, you can tell me all of GIT. That's all. All GIT is a hollow viscera. Mm-hmm. It may be stomach, it may be duodenum, it may be ileum, it may be jejunum. Yeah, it may be colon, even rectum. All are hollow viscous, no? Okay, apart from this, any other cause for pneumoperitoneum? Because this is a repeatedly asked question in your exam. University exam.
Disease.
Yeah, what? Diverticular disease. Diverticular disease. Why in diverticular disease, how you will get air under diaphragm? Okay, but diverticulitis you can, but what happens to the diverticula? I think you are not watching my videos carefully. Why I have to, I've said the video on two videos. One is pneumoperitoneum, another one is Chilaiditi syndrome. Two separate videos also I said with you. Why you are not telling the different causes? Here, no. In my classes, I told you in the first day itself, I am not going to teach you everything. My videos will teach you everything. Here in this class, you will be asked only questions only to test your knowledge. So what are the different causes apart from perforation of hollow viscous? You told only one cause. And of course, Chilaiditis you told. Apart from that, I told so many other causes also. What are they?
Colonic carcinoma.
Colonic carcinoma, how? That is all you finish already. GIT perforation you finish. Tell me other causes.
It happens after laparotomy or laparoscopy.
Yeah. After normal laparotomy, laparoscopy. Any other cause in female patient?
Tubal insufflation.
Tubal insufflation. Tubal insufflation. Why they are doing tubal insufflation? What is the cause? Why should you do tubal insufflation? Without understanding, you are not even know how to pronounce the insufflation. What do you mean by in which patients you will do tubal insufflation? Why they are doing it? Can you tell me?
To treat the tubal obstruction.
To rule out tubal obstruction. Okay. Or to see the patency of the tube. Agreed. Any other cause? Yeah, you told Chilaiditi syndrome. And one more cause is penetrating injury in the abdomen. Okay, right. I am going to the next student. Muhammad Firdas, are you there? Muhammad Firdas, to the next. Yeah, this is the different causes. Okay, they have discussed all. This is for epigastric pain. Can you tell me the different causes for epigastric pain? I'm not now asking about pneumoperitoneum. Epigastric pain, if some patients are having epigastric pain, what is the differential diagnosis? Can you tell me?
First, it can be gastritis or peptic ulcer disease, duodenal ulcer. Then it can be...
Louder, please. I am unable to hear
you. Pancreatitis.
Acute pancreatitis. Okay. Right. Okay. Small bowel obstruction. Okay. Then, okay. These are some of the...
My,
It could be acute cholangitis, pancreatitis. Everything is there in the screen. Even if you don't know anything, you can just see and answer, no. It is displayed already in the screen. And why you are not answering, I don't know. So you have to answer my classes. Unfortunately, okay, this is not face-to-face class. Otherwise, no. I'll be seeing all your faces also. One by one, I will ask you question after question. Now I am unable to see your faces and what is your, how you are answering and all, I cannot look. But okay, you have to try to answer. Why? I cannot understand. It is already displayed here. And why you are not telling, I don't know. So you must know the different causes for epigastric pain also. Okay? Right. The free air and the diaphragm indicates patient has perforated the viscus. This is supported by the evidence. Patient is having diffuse peritonitis by physical. Suppose if your patient is having perforated peritonitis, on physical examination, what is the hallmark sign? If it is perforation, what is the hallmark sign? Mohammed Fridas. What is the hallmark sign if it is perforative peritonitis? Okay, I'm going.
Rigidity, sir.
Rigidity, yeah. That is what I want. You have to answer. Only if you understand, then only you can answer. These are some of the basic principles. If it is a perforation, patient should develop rigidity, that is called board-like rigidity. That is the hallmark sign. Okay, apart from that, what else the patient will have in if you are examining the abdomen? Okay, in palpation, you are having rigidity. Suppose if you percuss, what will you get? What positive sign you will get if it is perforative peritonitis? You are percussing. What sign you will get? Okay, I'm going to the next student. Kuhilan Kumarasamy, are you there? Kuhilan.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what sign you will get if you percuss the perforated abdomen?
Not sure, sir.
Not sure. Okay, who knows the answer? Anybody knows the answer during percussion? What sign you will get? If anybody knows the answer, you can unmute and you can answer. Yeah? Hello? Anybody can answer. I don't want to keep on asking everybody. Gayatri Marimuthu, next student. If you percuss, what is the sign? Gayatri, you don't know. You know or you don't know?
Not sure, sir.
Did you watch?
I don't
if
know.
You percuss. Okay, what about Jeevita? Jeevita, anybody knows the answer or you don't know?
The obliquated sternus.
Yeah, very good. Who answered that? Who is that? Gayatriya?
Jemima.
Jeevita. Yeah? Who is Jemima, that?
Sir.
Yeah?
Jemima, sir.
Oh, you are B2. Jemima. Yeah. Okay. That is very good. So, obliteration of liver dullness. That is the sign. That is why, no, you have to watch my video. You have to not just once. You have to watch, understand what are the signs I have told clearly. One is this board-like rigidity, obliteration of liver dullness. Suppose if you auscultate, what sign you will get? What will you get?
Absent bowel sounds.
Yeah, absent bowel sound. That is called what? What is that called?
Silent abdomen.
Yeah, silent abdomen. Yeah, this is the sign you will get if you examine. Because definitely they are going to ask this. This is commonly several times. Plenty of times we have asked the same question. That's why I'm asking this. You must know these things. Okay, the most common causes for free air and the diaphragm or perforated ulcer, one thing, or perforated diverticulitis. Somebody told diverticulitis, it is not just diverticulitis, it is perforated diverticulitis only will produce pneumoperitoneum. Given the long-standing history of epigastric pain relieved by antacid, the most likely diagnosis is perforated, maybe gastric ulcer or duodenal ulcer, we don't know. Perforated peptic ulcer, that is what you can tell. Yeah, okay. In the history, what you have to ask, because it is pain, so you have to ask about the Socrates history. Okay, everything about pain abdomen you have to ask. And then you can ask about whether the patient is a known case of peptic ulcer disease. Okay, whether he is a smoker or not, whether patient is taking any NSAIDs or whether he is taking any steroids. All these things, and evidence of SIRS also you have to ask. And patient is lying without any movement in the bed, because if he moves, what will happen? That will aggravate the pain. Abdomen, there is guarding rigidity, but it is only rigidity. If guarding is there, usually rigidity won't be there. So either guarding or rigidity, you cannot tell both in a single patient. If it is guarding, what is it? What does it mean? Anybody? What is the difference between guarding and rigidity? I think I don't know, because I didn't take this examination of the abdomen to you. I don't know whether you know what is guarding and what is rigidity. What is the difference? Can you get both guarding and rigidity in the same patient?
No.
Yeah, what do you mean by guarding? What is the underlying pathology? When will you develop rigidity? And what is the difference between these two? These are some of the fundamental things you must know in surgery posting. You already finished how to examine abdomen last week. So you must be knowing what is guarding and what is rigidity. You might have been taught already. What is guarding? Can you tell me?
Guarding in the case of inflammation.
Yeah, it is only inflammation. Not the bowel is not perforated. So the pain will be where? Will it be generalized or localized?
Generalized.
No, no, it is not generalized. It is guarding is only localized.
Yes, sir.
Okay, it is localized. Is it continuous or intermittent? Guarding. Is it voluntary or involuntary guarding?
Voluntary.
It is voluntary. Okay, right. But what about rigidity? Is it voluntary or what? Rigidity.
Involuntary.
It is involuntary. This is the difference. You must know. No, in surgical posting, you are the beginners, no? Semester 6. So you must know, these are some of the fundamentals. You must know what is guarding rigidity. Last week, you have a full session of how to examine the abdomen. Then don't tell me that nobody has taught you what is guarding and rigidity. That is the fundamental thing. They have to teach you what is guarding and what is rigidity. Guarding is, okay, because of inflammation. Suppose our appendix is inflamed, you will get only guarding. Suppose if the same appendix is perforated, okay, then you will get rigidity. Okay, see, that is the difference. It is only inflammation. Here, rigidity, it is all perforated also. Guarding, localized. Rigidity is generalized. Guarding, intermittent. Rigidity is continuous. Okay, that is what you have to know. And rebound tenderness is also positive. So what is the pathophysiology? Previously, it is the hyperacidity that is the cause for peptic ulcer disease. Okay, now the latest theory is H. pylori infection. There are 5 types of gastric ulcer. And this is called modified Johnson's classification. Type 1 ulcer is in the lesser curve over the incisura angularis. Type 2 is one in the stomach, one in the duodenum. Type 3 ulcers, 3 pyloric. Type 4, proximally near the cardiac end of the stomach. Type 5, usually it is a erosive gastritis because of intake of NSAIDs. So you must know this classification. This is also repeat modified Johnson's classification of peptic ulcer disease. Yeah, I am hearing some voice. Who is that? So then workup, laboratory workup, leukocytosis, it's not specific, but the gold standard investigation here is just you have to take a plain X-ray, either chest X-ray or you can take abdominal X-ray, including both the diaphragm. What you are expected to see is free air and the diaphragm. This is called pneumoperitoneum. If you are in doubt, okay, but clinically you are thinking it is definitely some perforation, then you can do CT also. After giving oral gastrographin. Gastrographin is the is the contrast. Okay, now we have confirmed the diagnosis. We have seen what are the things you have to ask in the history, how to examine the patient, what are the signs you have to elicit. So the investigation is just you need not do any other investigation. The confirmatory investigation is just plain X-ray, either chest, but you have to take erect chest X-ray or erect or upright abdominal X-ray. So management, if it is duodenal ulcer perforation, you have to do primary closure with an omental patch. Can you tell me, any one of you, what is the name of this omental patch? Did you watch my video? Yes.
Graham omental patch repair.
Yeah, Graham's omental patch, very good. Graham's omental patch. Will you do only this omental patch or because it is already perforated? So what else you must do apart from Graham's omental patch? Can you tell me? Yeah, you have to do a thorough peritoneal lavage. Okay. Unlike, but we don't know if these sort of patients are coming, if they are asking management, you have to tell that I will do exploratory laparotomy, find out the cause, and I will treat the cause. That is what you have to write. Because it need not be just duodenal or gastric perforation. This could be a ileal perforation. This could be a colonic perforation. Who knows? Only after opening abdomen, you will see. So you have to write, if you are asking management, you have to write exploratory laparotomy and treat the cause. If it is duodenal perforation, I will do this. If it is gastric perforation, I will do this. Like that, you have to write. So if it is gastric perforation, the same thing like the same omental patch and all, but you have to take a biopsy. Why you are taking biopsy in gastric perforation? Can you tell me? Why you are taking biopsy?
Chance of becoming malignant, sir.
Yeah, that is why. Okay, you have to rule out malignancy. And you should know how to treat this H. pylori. That is, one is triple drug or four drugs. So one antibiotic, two antibiotics and one PPI. This is what you have to give. Clarithromycin and amoxicillin, both are antibiotic. One PPI, any PPI you can give. You have to give twice daily for 14 days. This is what you have to do. Additional acid reduction surgery, rarely we do this surgery. Okay, if the patient is very young, very stable, then okay, you can try to do vagotomy and pyloroplasty or gastrojejunostomy. Otherwise, usually we won't do any acid reduction surgery in these patients. This you have to remember. Okay, see, this is what pneumoperitoneum. Are you able to see this? I just want to show you. What is this one? Pneumoperitoneum. And what is this one? What you are seeing here. This is not pneumoperitoneum. This looks like fundal gastro. And above that, you are seeing pneumoperitoneum. Okay? You have to look on the right side. Because left side, you will get confused with the fundal gastro inside the stomach. That also will mimic like gas under diaphragm. And this last examination, no, the ASCII exam, the batch 40. Some of the students, I think more than 3, 4, 5 students, they wrote, because we won't give any case scenario. We ask, what is this? Can you read this X-ray, chest X-ray? They wrote some medical, condition, like car pulmonary. They wrote, and all the students, they got only 0 mark. So you had to look this one, this finding. This is pneumo, because the students may not be knowing that whether they are going to surgery, ASCII station, or medical station, they may not be knowing. But that is all right. But you have to look, this is quite obvious. There is an arrow is also there. Usually this arrow, it won't be there in the exam. So this is the pneumoperitoneum. And this is intraoperative picture. What you are seeing here, can you tell me what you are seeing here? Anybody? Gayatri Marimuthu, are you able to tell me? Answer, what is this? What is this you are seeing here? You are seeing a hole there. Are you seeing a hole there or not? Nobody is answering today.
Perforated duodenum also.
Yeah, okay, but I want to ask everyone. Only you are only answering. Yeah, I am hearing only your voice. That is why specifically I am asking the name, and I want those who are, I am asking your name, no, you have to answer. Okay, Gayatri.
Yes, sir.
Are you there? What is this? What is this?
Perforated.
Perforated what?
Duodenum.
Duodenum. What is this organ? You are seeing something there. What is this?
Your liver?
Yeah, this is liver. And you are seeing some yellow flakes also. And what is this one? Answer is there here already.
The patch.
Graham-somatoplexy. Okay. Why you are putting momentum over that? Why not directly suture it? Why you are putting momentum and then you are suturing? If you directly suture, what will happen? Did you watch my videos? The same pictures, I made a video. I sat with you also. That's why I am telling you, you must watch my video, learn everything and come to the class. Why not direct suturing? If you do direct suturing, what will happen? Anybody can answer this question. Open to all. If you directly suture, what will happen? Why we are putting that momentum over that perforation? Can you tell me? Nobody is answering. Okay, this is an inflamed tissue. If you are going to suture straight away, this will cut through. The sutures won't hold here in this inflamed area. That is why we are putting a momentum and then we are suturing here so that it won't get cut through. That is the idea. Okay, this is something like a cheese. If you want to take a bite in the cheese, will it hold the ligature? That is similar to that. Okay, right. Now I am going to the next case scenario. Maybe, who is that? Jeevita. Are you there, Jeevita? Jeevita?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please read. Please read the history and physical exam. Next case scenario.
Abdominal vein epigastric history. A 41-year-old woman presents to a woman complaining of severe and continuous epigastric pain for the past 24 hours. The pain radiates straight through her back. She had progressive nausea with vomiting. The vomitus is bile without blood. She has had enough but less severe epigastric in the past, usually after eating heavy meals, but and does not physical exam. On exam, she is a afebrile, per minute, blood pressure 26 feet, and she has a normal respiratory standard. She has no surgical scars on her.
Hello, are you there? I am unable to hear your voice. Hello? Hello?
Visible. Sir.
What happened? Your connection is not good. I'm not able to hear your voice. Okay, keep on reading. Yes. Can somebody else, can you read? Maybe she may be having problem.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah, now I'm able to hear you. Yeah. Yes. Start from here.
From the abdomen, sir?
Yeah, no, 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 here. She has no bruising around her umbilicus. This you
need. Yeah. She has no bruising.
You can stop. Ruvanka, are you?
Or along Ruvanka. Her rank counts are hypoactive. As a patient in her epigastric.
Yeah, I am not. I am unable to hear your voice. You can stop. You can mute your voice. Ruvanka, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you read from here? She has marked tenderness. Start from here.
She has marked tenderness to palpation in her epigastrium without guarding or rebound. The remainder of her abdomen is soft and non-tender to palpation. No masses or organomegaly are appreciated.
Okay, what do you think this, this patient is having?
Acute
pain. Yeah, pain radiates straight to her back. Okay, she is having nausea, vomiting. Okay, she had similar but less severe episode in the past. Physical examination, okay, only tenderness, that's all. No other positive finding. So most probably this looks like acute pancreatitis. Okay, how will you confirm it? Can you tell me?
An X-ray.
X-ray, you may not be seeing anything. So lab test, what you will do? Yeah, you can. Can you read this? Yeah, that doesn't matter. Ruvanka, you read the laboratory value.
WBC count of 17.2, amylase of 1,545, lipase of 1,134, ALT of 245, serum glucose of 156, and LDH of 180.
Yeah, all these are normal. Only which I have shown in the red color, WBC is elevated. Amylase is enormously elevated. Normal is only this much. Lipase is also elevated, almost 3 to 4 fold elevation. So this is definitely a case of, acute pancreatitis. But amylase will be elevated in some other condition also. But that is mild or moderate elevation, not this much. Okay? But you, you have to do abdominal series, which will show. But this abdominal series is not very important. You have to do CT scan. Okay? Okay, I will show you. These are the different causes which we have already discussed in the previous case scenario. What are the different causes for the pain of epigastric pain? So I am not going to repeat it. Most probably it is acute pancreatitis. This patient has classic presentation, consists of epigastric abdominal pain radiating straight to the back. She has had previous episode of pain, which resolved within few hours. Okay. Since the vast majority of cases are due to gallstone or alcohol, these are the two pathologies. And Ruvanka, can you tell me what is the mnemonic for the etiology for acute pancreatitis?
I get
mnemonic. Yeah, okay. I get smashed. You all know. But the commonest is gallstone or alcohol. Okay, consume, this patient does not consume alcohol. You have to think maybe probably she's having gallstone. Amylase and lipase both are elevated also. These are why it is acute pancreatitis. That is what we are telling. Okay, in the history. Okay, I'm going to the next student. Who is the next student? Prasanth Ravi, are you there?
Sir, he said his mic is not working, but he can hear, he couldn't.
Okay, right, leave it. Purnisa Durai Singham.
Yes, sir, it's me.
Are you there? Yeah, you are yes. Only talking. Okay. So, in the history, if it is pain, what do you have to ask? The same thing I told you already.
Socrates.
Socrates' history. What are the non-surgical medical condition that will mimic like epigastric pain? Two medical conditions, I told you. There are two medical conditions that will produce abdominal pain.
PUD?
No, PUD is not medical condition. Something, some problem in the thorax. Patient will have pain in the abdomen. What is this? Even in acute appendicitis also. Yeah, inferior wall MI and lower lobe pneumonia. These are the two things that will produce. You have to ask all these things in history and physical. Okay, do you have chest pain? You have to write. We will give only part of the history. We will ask you what else. What four more questions you will ask in this patient? So relevant question only you have to ask. Yeah, you can ask whether okay pain is there. You can ask whether jaundice is there or not. If jaundice is also there, probably it is a case of cholangitis. Who knows? So you have to ask all those things. So what is the pathology of acute pancreatitis? Who is going to answer? Purnisar Sankara Devan. Shankara Devan, Krishnamurti, are you there?
Yes, sir.
What is the pathology? How come your patient is getting acute pancreatitis? Did you watch or read anything?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me the pathology. Even if you don't know anything, it is there in the slide itself.
Basically due to inappropriate activation of pancreatic enzymes.
So what are the two enzymes that get activated? Because you cannot answer just this one. I want to know whether you have watched the video or you have read the PowerPoint or not. What are the two enzymes?
Trypsinogen and chymotrypsinogen.
Okay, what will happen to that? Normally, what will happen in acute pancreatitis? What will happen? Where these enzymes will normally get activated?
Usually, this enzyme will get activated in the duodenum, but in acute
pancreatitis. But here, it will get activated in the pancreas itself. So, it will go for what is called autodigestion or cannibalism. Yes. And this I have told several times. Gallstone and alcohol, common as CAS. The diagnosis you have to do only with history physicals and the abnormal amylase and lipase. And there are several severity criteria are there. Can you tell me who is that Sankara Devan? Can you tell me the different scoring system? Can you tell at least two scoring system? Tell me two scoring system.
One will be Ranson scoring system.
Ranson and?
Another one will be Glasgow-Imrie scoring system.
Okay, Glasgow-Imrie. I am going to the next student. Sonia. Sonia. Yeah, what are the other scoring system? He told only two things. What are the other things?
Balthazar CT scoring and the BASAP scoring.
BASAP is BISAP. Among all these scoring, which is the best? Best means immediately you can tell the prognosis. Which is the best among all these scoring systems? Yes?
The bicep scoring.
Bicep is the best scoring. Yeah, because immediately you can. I'm not going into all these parameters and all. You please go through it. Keep it with you and please read it. Maybe you may be asked in the exam. So you have to know everything. Work up again the same thing. Amylase lipase. And you have to do a right upper quadrant ultrasound. Right upper quadrant ultrasound to rule out gallstone. Yeah, that is the main thing. And epigastric ultrasound to rule out, the edematous pancreas. That is what you have to do. Okay, what is the management? Diagnosis we finished already. I am going to the next student, Kiran. What is the management in acute pancreatitis? Initial management, what is
The initial management is to admit the patient first into the ICU, and then we give analgesics, but we don't give analgesics, opioid analgesics like morphine, because it may cause vasospasm of the sphincter of Oddi. So we give analgesics like betadine. Then we progress with fluid rehydration, either renal lactate or normal saline, and also provide supplemental oxygen to the patient.
Okay.
You also have to make sure we monitor the vital signs, urine output, the venous, central venous pressure, as well as blood gases.
Okay, this is mainly conservative management. When will you operate? What are the indications for surgery?
If you cannot make a definitive diagnosis based on the patient's history and examination, if they're suspected pancreatic necrosis.
Very good. One more indication.
And if there's a pancreatic abscess,
okay, okay, very good. I'm going to the next student, Muhammad Hafiz. Are you there?
Yes.
Suppose your patient is having pancreatic abscess, what will you do?
Do exploratory laparotomy and then drain the abscess.
Drain the abscess. Okay, very good. Going to the next student, Jemima Thomas. Jemima Thomas?
Yes.
Are you there? Suppose if your patient is having, I want to show you this one. Yeah, 1 minute, wait. This is acute pancreatitis, only edema. This is big phlegmon, mass is there. And here, necrosis is there. Suppose if your patient is having necrose pancreas. Yeah, I told one particular terminology in my videos. If you do IV CECT and dual face CT scan, what you will see here? What is this called? I told something specific.
Won't get lighter.
Very good. Yeah, that's what I want. That means you have watched my video already. It is not there in many of the textbooks, not even in Bailey and Law. So unless you watch my video, you cannot tell it won't get light up. That is the terminology we use. It is not getting light up. Okay, this area is normal. So if it is necrose, what will you do? What will you do if it is necrose pancreas? Hello? Hello, Jemima, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What surgery you will do? That's what I'm asking you. If you have found out your patient is having necrose pancreas, what will you do?
You would do a debridement, then you do lavage.
Very good. That's what I'm asking. What is the name of that debridement? You are removing the necrose part. It is called pancreatic necrosectomy. Pancreatic necrosectomy. After that, continuously, you had to give the lavage, continuous lavage. I have shared one picture with you in that one. Yeah, you can go and I think that's it. But okay, wait a minute. Let me see whether I'm having anything in the AAC. Acute pancreatitis. Yeah, it is there. Okay, I just want to show you something from this one also. I told you already, this is not my PowerPoint. This is teaching PowerPoint from Association for Surgical Education by American College of Surgeons. I have shared all these 25 teaching PowerPoint slides in your P2S1, that MS Teams. It is there. Go to the files. There is a folder called ASE. Yeah? ASE means Association of Surgical Education. PowerPoint slide is there. You can go and you can download all the 25 these teaching videos. These are very good things. That is why. So, okay, this is a 64-year-old male admitted to an outside hospital with 4-day history of progressively worsening epigastric pain without any radiation. Sometimes there may not be any radiation at all, not radiating to the back also. Okay, what other points you will ask? Definitely you have to ask about whether patient is having any similar previous episode, whether he is an alcoholic, all those things you must ask. This is what you have to ask in short. Characterization of symptom. Temporal sequence is the timing. I have shown you the same thing in all the thing, all my the previous yesterday's right upper quadrant pain also, the aggravating relieving factors, pertinent past medical history, review of system, medication, relevant family history, associated signs and symptoms. These are the things you have to ask in history. Please keep it in mind. Whatever case we are going to give you for your MEQ, the first question invariably will be, because we are going to give only part of the history, then we will ask you, what are the four more questions or three more questions you will ask in this patient? So you have to think of all these things. Not only the symptoms the patient is having, you have to talk about the timing sequence, aggravating relieving factors, and all these things you have to ask. Please remember this one, this slide. Okay, patient is telling pain is constant and remitting, that is, it is not relieved by anything, going through to his back. Now he is telling it is going to the back. Pain started after beer and pizza 4 days prior, progressively worsening since then. Nausea and vomiting 3 days. Some indigestion history, never like this. No relief with OTC, over-the-counter, Pepcid, some drugs. Maybe antacids and analgesic. The patient is not relieved from the pain. No significant past medical and surgical history, no medication, no allergies. He is a smoker. One pack per day, 40 years. See, he drinks ethanol also, alcohol also, heavy drinker. Every day he drinks. But he denies drug abuse. Family history is also non-contributory. What is your differential diagnosis? We have discussed already. Okay, what you will do? Vital signs, temperature is almost slightly elevated, yes. And appearance, he is lying still with moderate distress. He is not jaundiced. Sclera is anicteric. Mucous membrane is dry because he has vomited several times. Respiration is normal. CVS is also normal. Abdomen soft, moderately distended in the epigastric region because of ileus. And tender in the mid-epigastric region, right upper quadrant, no palpable mass, bowel sounds are heard. And extremity is normal, rectal exam also normal, everything is normal. So these are the differential diagnosis again. Okay, you have to do the lab investigation, especially mainly amylase and lipase. You must do, okay? And these are the reports. So hemoglobin normal, electrolyte, okay, almost normal. Amylase is also not, but it's elevated, not that much elevated. So you have to confirm your diagnosis by doing a CT scan. So this is the Ranson's criteria. What are the various criteria? On admission, 5 criteria. At 48 hours, 6 more criteria. So total score in Ranson's is 11. If it is more than 7, definitely your patient is going to die. Mortality. If it is more than 7 to 8, see, 100% mortality. That's the problem. So, Ranson's criteria. So, what you will do? Mild case, you have to manage conservatively like this. But admit the patient either in ICU, you have to admit. IV fluids, you have to give. Keep the patient NPO to give rest to the pancreas. Catheterize the bladder. Then you can put NG tube also. Give, these are the causes for, that is, I get smashed, the same one. So you have to take abdominal X-ray, right upper quadrant ultrasound, CT scan, HIDA scan and all, usually that is for A calculus scoliosis study, not for pancreatitis. Yeah, maybe it is a calculus cholecystitis. Otherwise, if it is biliary pathology, if you are suspecting, some cholelithiasis producing the pancreatitis, then you have to do MRCP. Otherwise, ultrasound, you are seeing a gallstone. Yeah, this is here, you are seeing a edematous pancreas. See here, this is a CECT. Yeah, I'm not discussing it because we have discussed it already. So nothing by mouth, the same thing they are repeating. I'm not repeating it. the intravenous cholangiogram they are showing here, but not for this one. Only if there is any gallbladder pathology, then only you have to do it. Yeah, okay. Otherwise, there is no need. Here also they are showing biliary pathology. Maybe the patient is having a stone somewhere here in the common channel producing acute pancreatitis. But usually, in acute pancreatitis, you should not do ERCP because ERCP itself is a cause for pancreatitis. This will aggravate the problem. But if your patient is having a cholangitis, then okay, you should do ERCP. Otherwise, yeah, what is happening? This is a patient with the same thing, big mass is there. Yeah. And this is what is called, see, this is the continuous irrigation. They haven't closed the abdomen at all. Temporary abdominal closure. They have put a mesh, non-adherent mesh. This is called laparostomy. See, one tube is going in, another tube is coming out. So continuously fluid is going in. This is what is called continuous lavage of the peritoneal lavage. After necrosectomy, they are doing it. They haven't closed it because after some time, they will remove this one and they will have a look inside. Yeah, management and all I have discussed. I'm not going to repeat it again. This is pancreatic necrosis. Okay, it is not getting light up some areas. Yeah, the same thing. Yeah. Pancreatic ascites also can happen. Lot of fluid in the peritoneal cavity. Yeah. Okay. That's it. Yeah, I'm not, because I have discussed already. Students, are you there? Now you can ask me question. Hello.
Sir.
Yes.
Earlier in the case scenario, one of the highlighted history was that the patient had no bruises over the umbilicus and the flanks. Why is that relevant history, sir?
That is Cullen sign and the great NS sign. Suppose if it is hemorrhagic pancreatitis, you will get bruising in the disease because of retroperitoneal hemorrhage. Because pancreas is a retroperitoneal organ, this is hemorrhagic pancreatitis. You will get it only in hemorrhagic pancreatitis. I think I have discussed in my video Cullen sign, great NS sign, and Fox sign. Fox sign is what? Can you tell me? FOX, Fox.
There's discoloration around the inguinal ligament.
Yeah, very good. That's it. Yeah. Because the pancreatitis is not one, this is a spectrum of disease. It could be a mild one or it could be a severe one. The spectrum. If it is a mild one, okay, conservative treatment. If it is a very severe one, okay, then you have to do surgery. If it is necrosis or hemorrhagic pancreatitis or pancreatic abscess, you have to do surgery. Otherwise, there is no surgery. But all your patients, whether it is mild or severe, all patients, this is the spectrum. Okay, even if it is mild or severe, you have to admit all the patients to ICU only or high dependency unit. Okay. Yes. Any other doubt by anybody? Hello.
Sir,
hello.
No
doubt. Okay. Okay, in that case, okay, I am closing it. Tomorrow's topic is acute abdomen PBL class. Okay, tomorrow afternoon. Please read and come to my class. What time? 2:30. 2:30.
Okay, sir,